Well, hey there, guys, and welcome to the Sunday edition of Mailbag. And I'm not going to lie, we record this a few days ago. But I am, of course, your co-host today. My name is John Cabey, and I'm joined this week by Christian Harloff.
Oh, man, you pulled the magic trick. I thought today was Sunday.
we just happened to come into the office today, right. And I'm wearing the same clothes I was wearing yesterday. Now, of course, this is the show where all we do is take your questions. How do you get a question to us? It's simple. Just jump on your email and send us an email to collidervideo@gmail.com. Every day, Monday through Friday, we take a couple of your questions on Movie Talk, then here on the weekends. And also, I take questions from Twitter and from Facebook, and wherever you guys can send questions to me, that's what we do. So, without any further ado, let's jump right into it. And the first question today comes to us from Caleb Sutherland, who writes, "Hey guys, I love the show. My most anticipated film, besides Star Wars, is Dunkirk. Are you guys excited to see this film? And if you are, do you have any expectations for it since it's a Christopher Nolan film? Are you looking forward to Dunkirk? And if so, how much of that is because it's Christopher Nolan?"
A lot of it. I'm not going to try to hide that I'm, whether you want to say, a Nolan fanboy or the fact that I look forward. This is one of the great filmmakers that we have right
today,
now.
Today, yeah.
And I'm a World War II buff. I mean, so you mix both of those things together and you have Christopher Nolan putting together this piece. And I happen to really like the trailers that we saw. I know some people were a little underwhelmed by the trailers. But then from what I heard, that they showed like a 10-minute extended preview.
And that's right. They
some
did.
Some of those people who were disappointed by it, those concerns were off the table. There's something about the way that Christopher Nolan just shoots movies, gets you engaged, gets performances out of actors, that his movies become events. And we've talked about this many times on Movie Talk and on other shows, that we're in an age where there are certain directors who have essentially replaced the movie star.
Yep.
Tarantino is someone who does
and writers
that.
To some degree too.
Absolutely. Edgar Wright is someone who does that, maybe not in box office numbers, but you get excited for an Edgar Wright movie in the same way, obviously, you get excited for a Christopher Nolan film. There's just certain directors that can do that, and he's one of them.
Hey, look, I think the trailers for Dunkirk have been good. They're good trailers. But you take off that name, Christopher Nolan, and I'm not nearly as excited.
Oh, right.
The name is there. I'm super excited. This is the guy who gave us movies like Insomnia, The Prestige, Memento, Inception, Interstellar, and we haven't even talked about his Batman movies yet.
Right.
That's the director we're talking about and what he's bringing to this. So when you see that same trailer and then you have those tinted glasses on where you realize this is a Christopher Nolan film, you start to see the potential in that film. Suddenly that trailer isn't just another run-of-the-mill war trailer. It's a trailer that you know is in the hands of a guy who is one of, as you so eloquently put, is one of the best filmmakers working around today. So number one, yes, I'm very much looking forward to Dunkirk. And number two, yes, I admit it's a lot of it has to do with because of who is in the director's chair. And until he gives us a movie that stinks, and he hasn't done that yet.
Yeah.
And of all the films he's done, not one has stunk. Some are better than others. But until he gives us one that stinks, I'm always going to give a Christopher Nolan film the benefit of the doubt.
And even then, even if it did stink, you'd be like, ah, I didn't like the last one, but he's done so much in his past.
Yeah, then it'd be one.
Right.
One.
Right.
But until then, you got to give him the benefit of the doubt. All right, let's move on to the next question. And the next question today comes to us from Donovan Hill, who writes, "I would like to know why reviewers do not say anything if there's an after credit scene in a movie or not. I was watching Ouija Origin of Evil and just thought to fast forward to the end of the credits to see if there was anything after. I had no idea there was an after credit scene in the movie. Do you think reviewers should say if there is something at the end of the credits so people would know to stay or not?" Christian.
Okay. this is a bad example you give us here, and I'll tell you why.
I love answers to start with, okay.
Well, because the second he said this, I'm thinking a lot of the times, if you're talking about Doctor Strange, then you're going to hear us say, hey, stick to the credits of Doctor Strange because it becomes certain. There's certain events. There are certain movies that have these post-credit scenes that relate to future movies and other things, and sometimes not, and most of the times reviewers will do that. Ouija, everyone's just trying to get the hell out of the movie theater. No one wants to sit around and watch anything, so no one knew. That's why, and I'm not even kidding. No one knew, because I can guarantee you, you're not sitting around waiting for the after credit. That was a dopey decision by the only way you're supposed to find it was to find it on Blu-ray, because you probably just fell asleep, left it on, it pops up, there's something else there.
Although, I will say this, Ouija Origin of Evil was significantly better than the first one. I'll give it that. But you're right. Like, a lot of times in these screenings, couple things keep in mind. Number one, a lot of these critics, they have to see 5 or 6 of these screenings a week. And when the, so when the credits start to roll, they just want to get up and go home.
Right.
But the second thing is this. There have been many examples of movies that have after credit scenes that they do not show them at press screenings. Yeah. Marvel is notorious for this.
Sometimes if there's 2 Marvel ones, sometimes they'll just show you one.
Sometimes one, yeah. Yep.
Or and, sometimes and never.
Sometimes not at all. Yeah. And so a lot of times not even the critics know if there is not. Then there's a third kind of wild card aspect to this that sometimes there are fans out there that even if you say there's an after credit scene,
they don't want to know.
They'll yell, spoiler! Right. You just gave spoiler. No, we're just letting you know there's something there.
Right.
I wanted to sit through the credits and find out myself. Well, yeah. Whatever.
I think it's normally when it's Marvel or DC, you'll hear, especially on our end, the stick around and wait. But when it comes to special movies that you don't normally even think they're going to have one and it just pops up, it's probably because we're already in our car by the time it's playing.
But for as far as we go, when we see a movie, if there's an after credits scene, we generally will tell you guys, hey, and make sure you stick around for the credits. We won't say what is in it or any of that kind of stuff. We'll just generally say, and if we don't say anything, then that probably means either A, there is no after credits scene, or B, they just didn't show it to us.
Is there a post credits scene in Kong?
Oh, yes, there is.
See?
There's a post-credit scene in Kong. You know what? The funny thing is, this was the first time ever that I've had this happen. We were in a press screening watching, getting ready to watch Kong, and the studio rep actually came up before the movie started and told us,
stick around.
Hey, everybody, make sure you stick around to after the credits.
Right.
That was actually very helpful. Thank you, Warner Brothers,
because
for doing that.
Because you're not expecting normally to stick around. Like when you go to these credits screenings for DC and Marvel movies now, people stick around because they've been accustomed to do so.
Yeah.
It wasn't always like that. There were a lot of times people would be leaving in the middle of the Marvel ones, but now they know to do it. But so it was smart for Warner Brothers to do that.
And by the way, it is safe to leave at the end of Logan, by the way.
Right.
Okay, well, let's move on to the next question. The next question comes to us from Adam Buddha, who writes, so I know it's only February, but I guess we can crown Lego Batman as the best animated film of the year so far. I've seen it 3 times already. I took a look at the remaining major animated films for the rest of 2017, and I don't see anything on the horizon that could possibly top it, at least in my opinion. Pixar does have Coco coming out later this year, but I really don't know anything about it in terms of buzz. What are your guys' thoughts? I'd love to see sweet redemption for the Lego movie franchise receiving one of the biggest, to make up for one of the biggest Oscar snubs of all time. I'm not going to disagree with you, because that year that the Lego movie, I still have a hard time believing it. Like, I say it out loud and it's hard to believe it. The Lego movie did not get nominated for Best Animated Film. We were all ready to crown it the winner at the Oscars. That the Lego movie is not just going to get nominated for Best Animated Film. It was going to win Best Animated Film, and it didn't get nominated. That is still crazy to me. Are we ready to crown the animated, the Lego Batman movie at this point? No. But I'll say this, and I was mentioning this about Logan the other day too. If in terms of animated films, if 5 other animated films come out this year that are better than the Lego Batman movie, this is going to be one of the greatest years of animation in the history of animated films. Because the Lego Batman movie is great. And if you get 5 films that top it, that will be probably the best year on record ever. I just can't see that happening, though. So I'm ready to say that I do believe Lego Batman will get nominated, but we'll just have to wait and see the rest of the year. What do you think the chances are?
We have to wait and see for sure. Now, we also don't know if something like My Life is a Zucchini, whatever.
Right,
it's like those types of movies that come out of nowhere. That could happen again, and we won't hear about it or see it until the last minute, and could always bump out something like Lego Batman. But in Coco, yes, but this is another year, and I think that they did it 2 years ago with two. Now is Coco is Pixar or is Coco Disney?
It's Pixar, I believe.
Okay, because if that is the case, this is the second time in like 3 years that Pixar is going to release 2 movies in 1 year.
They did that's Good their Dinosaur new pattern.
Inside Out.
Yep.
They hadn't done that before until Inside Out and Good Dinosaur. Now we're getting that and Cars 3. I thought Cars 1 was okay at best, and I thought the second one was horrible. What if Pixar spins it in a direction to where it becomes great, and Cars 3 is the best of the 3, and does something to where that could possibly be best animated? It's a long shot, because it also, I do think part 1 and 2 have left sour tastes in everybody's mouths, fans and critics, and I don't think anyone was calling for a Cars 3.
but it's Pixar, so you never count them out of what they can do story-wise. And then I don't know if Disney has anything else coming out or what DreamWorks has coming, but there are things as far as why, like buzz-wise, why I didn't hear anything, because it's not time to market
not time
yet.
To buzz yet.
It's not
yeah.
time to buzz yet. Once they start screening it too, and if Coco is awesome, that's when you hear the buzz.
All right, let's move on to the next question. The next question today comes from Lucian Vinatala, who writes, "Hello, John and crew. Any updates about Alita Battle Angel? And do you still believe that Robert Rodriguez was a bad choice to direct?" Yeah, so James Cameron has been working for a long time on this Battle Angel movie. Mm-hmm. A lot of us have been waiting for him to do it. And quite frankly, people like me have been much more wanting him to do that movie than before he went back to Pandora to do Avatar 2, 3, 4, and 5.
No, they're doing 5 also? There's 2, 3, and 4.
I think...
You might be right. No, you're right. You're absolutely right. There's 4 of them.
Is it
you're
4
right.
more yep. that are coming? Yep. Yeah. So, I don't know. Maybe. I hope I'm wrong.
No, you're right. Yeah. Whether or not anyway, that happens, we'll see.
But Battle Angel is one that he's had on his burner for over a decade.
Yeah.
And talking about, and the idea about James Cameron doing that movie has had us salivating. He has decided to work as a producer on it and get in another director in Robert Rodriguez. Now, I know John Schnepp.
I heard it.
He and I disagree on this. Now, he's very convinced. Maybe a lot of you guys would agree with Schnepp on this. He still believes that Cameron's going to be very involved in this movie. I'm like, there's no chance in hell he's going to be that involved because he's got 4 more Avatar movies he's making yeah. back to back to back to back that he's been working on forever. So he's been giving all of his time and attention to. So they got in Robert Rodriguez. Robert Rodriguez is a guy who I think is a very cool personality in the world of movies. I think people like Robert Rodriguez are absolutely needed for the movie industry to stay fresh and vibrant and all that kind of stuff. But Robert Rodriguez himself... When I first heard he was going to be directing this instead of James Cameron, I was skeptical, and I still am to a degree. Yes, he's given us movies like Dust Till Dawn and Desperado and stuff like that, but he also did Spy Kids 2 and Spy Kids 3.
Machete 2.
Machete and Machete 2, the follow-up to that. He did Sin City 2. He's not on a good... In baseball terms, he's in a slump.
Right.
And so, you know, I'd heard rumors that he was going to do... I don't know if I'm allowed to say that or not, so I take that back. But look, I heard rumors of him doing other film projects that I thought might be nice, better stepping stones, but this, I'm still skeptical. Look, I'm going to go into this if it ever gets off the ground, because I haven't heard any new news about it. I haven't heard of any progress because James Cameron's completely tied up in other stuff. I haven't heard of any progress yet at this point. If it ever actually happens, and I'll still put that if on there, if it ever happens, I will go into it and totally give it a shot. Because look, who knew that a movie that he and Robert are... Quentin Tarantino were doing together that what did they call Grindhouse? The yeah. Grindhouse film, you know, between Death Proof and what was it, Planet Terror?
Oh, yeah, something like that.
That Planet Terror, yeah. The Robert Rodriguez one, would be the better of the two.
Right.
But it was. So, look, he's got some greatness in him. Let's just see if he can bring it out with this.
I don't know enough about the story to whether I'm going to be excited or disappointed, to be honest. But when Cameron's involved or directing, I do get excited for things. But now, as far as him producing and whether or not he can, I tend to side with you a little bit more, to where it's not only seems like it's going to be hard because of the 4 Avatar sequels that he's doing, but potentially now he's getting the rights back for Terminator, and he's supposed to be involved doing that. Whether or not, you know, that's a whole other argument, or whether or not you think he's going to be involved in that if that gets off the ground. And as far as Robert Rodriguez goes, I feel the same way. I think that he's someone that you want involved in the movie community. He is a hardcore movie fan. You hear the way that he talks about movies. He's very passionate about things. He tries new things. He tries different things. But I haven't been a fan of a lot of the stuff that he's been doing recently. That doesn't mean that I'm going to say, I don't want to see what that guy can do with Battle Angel. I don't know enough about it to say if he's got a cool vision for it and it works. I am the only person on the planet that liked Sin City 2. I know that. I know you liked it. I know. It's like when people ask what's the one movie that everyone hated that you liked, that should be my answer. And I understand.
Awesome.
I totally get where everyone. It's not like one of those things where I'm like, how did you guys not like that movie? I get it. I understand everyone coming out going, oh, it's unbelievably awful. I just wound up liking it. But let's see what happens. I don't necessarily think it's going to happen, to be honest. I think the whole thing's going to die, but I don't care one way or another.
Yeah, I got a feeling there's like a good 25% chance this movie doesn't happen at all.
Yeah.
All right, the next question today comes to us from Aaron Tenney, who writes, do you think Logan will be the best superhero movie of the year? I cannot remember. Have you had a chance to see Logan? Yeah. You've seen Logan. It's tough to
best
say.
Best or profitable?
Well, best. Profitable, no. It's not going to be the most profitable of the year. Not a chance.
I think it's going to be hard to find a movie that is better quality-wise and different and took the kind of chances that Logan did. It had that, sure, it's a bigger budget movie, but it had that small budget movie feel. It had the Hell or High Water feel to it. It had this different kind of independent feel off a familiar franchise with a character that you were familiar with, but put it in very different circumstances. But yet, taking back the way that we knew him as in the comic books, but still added something completely fresh and new. And it was emotionally just really charging. Not that other superhero movies this year won't be, but they're on a much grander scale, and they're going to be, even if they try to do certain things differently, it's still going to be a little bit more familiar than this movie was. And I think that that's what Logan has going for it, is because it is really a quality film. And I think the other ones could be too, but I just mean this could be the best out of all of them.
It's a high bar.
Yeah.
I mean, it set a high, high bar. I mean, first of all, the Lego Batman movie came out of the gates, and I guess that's technically the first comic movie of the year. It was great. Logan sets an unbelievably high bar. Mm. Now, look, we've got a couple of very good ones coming out. We got Guardians of the Galaxy 2.
Which looks great.
I'm expecting big things from that. I know a lot of people snicker a little bit when I say it, but we got Wonder Woman coming out. I still have a lot of faith in Wonder Woman. I think Wonder Woman is going to impress a lot of people. I think it's going to be the first critically praised
DC film.
Of the DCEU.
Right.
Yeah, of the DCEU. I think it's going to be the first critically praised, like 75% or higher on Rotten Tomatoes. I think Wonder Woman's going to be that. We got Spider-Man Homecoming.
All movies so far, all the ones that you mentioned so far, I'm looking forward to all of them.
Trailers look good.
Yeah.
Valerian, the City of a Thousand Planets, I'm not expecting good things from that. I didn't like the trailer at all.
I heard some good things from the Comic-Con buzz, that the stuff that they show, but I haven't really seen it.
The comic is great.
Yeah.
The comic's great.
Luc Besson is very excited about it. I mean, he's passionate behind it, but yeah, I don't really expect great things.
I think right now, the first three that I mentioned, I think Guardians of the Galaxy 2, Wonder Woman, and Spider-Man Homecoming, I think these films have the potential to top Logan.
Four?
But it's...
with him and Hulk running around together? There's a lot of movies that could be really good, for
sure.
I'll
say this. I think there are a number of films coming out this year that have the potential to top Logan. I don't expect them to top Logan, though.
I agree.
I mean, Logan is just so solid from top to bottom. Look, I've said it before. It is the movie that gives you everything. Great emotional beats. Mm-hmm. Great horror beats. Great action beats.
That's what I meant. It's how different it was on all scales. Because I can see us on all those movies you mentioned. I could see us saying, that was awesome to see Thor and Hulk together. And it was elements of Planet Hulk. But it's still, I just can't imagine, and I could be wrong, I just can't imagine it's going to have that same kind of emotional impact that Logan did. Because you have to realize, Logan, you're working with 17 years of Wolverine.
Yeah.
Like 17 years of this guy, in one way or another, we know of him doing Wolverine, and it's taken this path to do this movie and not be redundant. Like, even if you look at something like Days of Future Past, which I love, is one of my favorite X-Men movies, if not this, you know, of the universe of Bryan Singer movies.
Yeah.
And you look at that movie, and there's still a lot of familiar elements.
Yeah.
Things that you have seen before.
Probably by design.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
This movie does not do that.
Yeah.
It is, sure, you see the claws and you hear mutants, but it's not that. It's a different movie. The themes are different, and it's going to be hard to beat it.
If one or two movies do top Logan, I'll tell you, this will be the best year in comic book movie history.
Totally.
If two films come out of those four we mentioned, Thor, Wonder Woman, Guardians of the Galaxy, Spider-Man Homecoming, if two of those are better than Thor, just put it right down right now, this will be the best year in comic book history.
Yeah.
It's a tall order, though, man. All right, let's move on to the next question. The next question comes to us from Phil Lee, who writes, which is the bigger controversy, the Oscar Best Picture thing or Nerf Herder?
Oh, that's great. I knew that was coming. I would have to say the Oscars. But the Nerf Herder, if you're not familiar with what Mr. Phil is talking about here, it's like you had Freddie Prinze Jr. and Sam Witwer, the Force Bros in Schmodown, battled this man right here, John Campia and Ken Napsok. And unlike Moonlight, who actually won and were given the win, they actually kind of won and were not given the win, because we don't reverse calls in football. So, but I would say that the Oscars were a little bit more of the mishap.
Yes, obviously the Oscars were, but I remember I had a lot of people tweet. I think they tweeted to you too. Some people showed the image of, you know, at the end of the Oscars, the producer for La La Land actually held up the car that said Best Picture, like, Moonlight. See Moonlight.
He did the Freddie Prinze Jr. rule.
Yeah, he did. That's right. So people sent us pictures that says that said Movie Trivia Schmodown, The Council on that. Yeah. So great question. Thank you so much for the question. The next question comes to us from Kendall Barker, who writes, will the success of Logan cause a change of direction for the Fox movies, especially after the other successes of Deadpool and the failure of X-Men Apocalypse?
I think that they're doing that already. I think that they started doing that already. And I think that as much we give studios crap sometimes, especially Fox, we have given Fox a lot of crap, and rightfully
so.
For the way that they handled Fantastic Four was an absolute nightmare, disaster, to be honest. And then when they're started to say, oh, we're going to put $200 million in that Channing Tatum
Gambit
movie. And you're like, what are they doing? And then they don't take the big risk. They take a risk, but they don't take a big risk by dumping a lot of money in the first Deadpool because they don't know what it's going to do. But they still make the movie with a low amount of money, and they let Ryan Reynolds make the movie scared. They do it, and at the time, thinking that they're still going to do this Gambit movie, then Deadpool has the success that it does, and then the Gambit movie started to go away. You'd have to think that at some point, some of the Fox, I'd like to at least imagine this is what happened. They go, we don't need to spend this.
Yeah.
Look at how much money this made. And then I don't think you get a rated R Logan movie if you didn't get the success of Deadpool.
No chance.
There's no way to do it. And that was a smart announcement. So then Fox is taking risks right now, and they are changing up things, and they're trying to do different things. I think you still see the bigger movies. I mean, look, they even took a risk with Kingsman. They made Kingsman, which was
rated
also
R.
A rated. People kept talking about Deadpool. This is the first thing. I mean, they did it with Kingsman already, and it worked. They just didn't. It was such a different thing because they did it with an X-Men type franchise and a big character like that. So they are making moves. I don't think Logan's going to be the one to change it. They're already in the process of doing it.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think Logan is the result of the change happening, not the cause of the change happening. If anything, it just kind of reaffirms their direction. Plus, even if you look now at their television properties, if you look at Legion, you know, it has a different kind of tone to it. I do think you see them doing that. And it's, once again, I know I harp on this a lot, but it once again kind of harkens to the thing about why I'm so glad, despite there's this big call, send this X property back to Marvel. Send, you know, that X property back to Marvel. No, keep the X properties at Fox, because these movies, Deadpool, this Logan movie, they never would have been made at Marvel.
Right.
They just wouldn't have done it. It wouldn't have happened.
Marvel's not going to be making rated R superhero movies.
So every once in a while, Fox gives us X-Men Origins Wolverine, and every once in a while, they give us a Fantastic Four, but they also give us First Class and Days of Future Past and Deadpool and Logan and X-Men 2. I mean, so I love what they're doing, and I love that they're taking kind of a new direction.
Yeah, and X-Men's doing it. I mean, from what the rumors are, whether it's Simon Kinberg doing the next one, I mean, Sophie Turner already said that she's about to start filming one. So we're going to see something in the PG-13, how they're going to change it and switch it from, they've got to get away from Apocalypse. I mean, from that tone didn't really work at all. The script didn't work at all.
And the movie was a mess.
Yeah, I think it was a good move to go away from Bryan Singer now. I think he's done it. He's played his part in the X-Men universe, and let's see wherever the next director takes us.
All right, the next question today comes to us from Brooklyn Vall, who writes, thoughts on a possible Chris Moneymaker biopic, or even just a movie on the Moneymaker effect? Now, for those of you who don't recognize the name Chris Moneymaker, Chris Moneymaker is an average dude who played some online poker and won this little, you know, this little what they call satellite tournament stuff, and got himself into the World Series of Poker, which is a $10,000 buy-in to get into the World Series of Poker. So he managed to win these little satellites as an online guy, got into the World Series of Poker, and when you know it, he ended up winning the whole damn thing. And I can't remember how many millions of dollars he won for winning the World Series of Poker, but that thing started what they call the Moneymaker effect. And in essence, that suddenly online poker, imagine if you were a guy and you love football and you found there's a way that an average Joe like you could actually get in and play in the Super Bowl.
Right.
That's what happened in the world of poker with this guy named Chris Moneymaker. And the effect is now kind of worn off, but it started this huge influx. Like, the reason, I don't think the World Series of Poker is being covered on ESPN today if it wasn't for what happened with Chris Moneymaker. I mean, it just changed the landscape of things. Yes, this is a movie you could make. You can make a biopic on this. Maybe not a biopic on the entire life of Chris Moneymaker, but a biopic on the story of the Moneymaker effect as you're talking about. That would be kind of interesting.
It sounds fascinating. I didn't know anything about it, really. But listening to you talk about it, I immediately thought of Rounders, and I also thought of The Flamingo Kid with it was late Gary Marshall and Matt Dillon. Card movies can be very exciting. They really can. It doesn't use it really. Yeah, the stakes behind it. And I
just watch Casino Royale.
Yeah, man, I'd want to see the actual. I don't necessarily need to know the guy's whole life story. You could do something in the beginning of kind of how he started to do what he's doing, but to find out how he did it, the actual World Series itself, playing in it, getting there, winning it.
It's Eddie the Eagle. With poker.
Cards, yeah. How old was he at the time?
I think he was like in his mid-30s.
Okay, I mean, that's a pretty cool role. I think it would be a good movie.
All right, the next question today comes to us from Aaron LeBlanc, who writes...
If they make an emoji movie, I mean, come on.
Should they reboot the Pink Panther, and who do you think they should cast? Look, first of all, the Pink Panther movies, now going back to the originals, are some of the greatest, the most classic comedies like ever. Peter Sellers, I mean, forever. Now, a lot of people don't even realize, because they were kind of bad and they came and went pretty quick, that Steve Martin did kind of reboot it. Applauded the effort. Steve Martin is a genius. But it didn't work. Should they do it again? I don't know that in this day and age, a true Pink Panther reboot can work. I think we saw Johnny Depp try to do it a couple years ago with, what was the name of that stupid movie mustache?
Oh, yeah, Mordecai was horrendous.
Mordecai, thank you. Fact checker Jonathan over there. How bad was that?
That was awful. It was one of the worst movies of the year.
That was clearly heavily inspired by Pink Panther. I don't think you could do it again, but oh my God, guys, if you've not watched some of the original Pink Panther, Peter Sellers Pink Panther movies, go and watch them.
Yeah, and I think that, and it's funny to hear you say that, because I think that there are certain people, I'm curious too, I wonder that if for people of a certain age that they went back and watched it, would you respond to it? If you're in your younger 20s, if you're in your teens, I'm not saying you would, you wouldn't. I'm just curious if you would, going back and watching those movies, is that type of, because movies and comedy, they get dated, you know? And I think that could be the case. I love the Pink Panther movies, the Peter Sellers ones. I don't think it could work now for a lot of different reasons. I don't know if that tone necessarily works anymore. I don't know if that story necessarily works anymore. And I think that if 10 years ago, if they would have done it again, Steve Carell, somebody that probably could have done it. But there are a lot of comedic stars out there right now. But who is like the comedic star right now? And could that guy or girl do it? Because that's what would happen. It would wind up being Melissa McCarthy or something right now. That's what would happen. And I don't know if that's a movie that I would want to see her do, because that's probably how it would shift and where it would go. And I'd rather see her do original stuff if that's the case, because I don't know who the person is that could carry on and do justice to what Sellers did.
The only name that, like, because you think of some big comedic stars, but a lot of the bigger comedic stars are kind of locked into a certain shtick.
Yeah.
Whether you're talking about a Will Ferrell or a Kevin Hart or something like that.
Those guys are getting too old. I mean,
maybe a Steve Carell.
I said Carell.
Oh, did you mention Carell?
I said 10 years ago, Carell would have been the guy. Okay. Because I think Carell now, you could probably still do it with him.
But he kind of already did was Get Smart, I guess.
That's kind of what I thought. I don't know if you don't, I don't think that you would need to do it.
All right, let's move on to the next question. The next question comes to us from Jared Ouellette, who writes, "Hey guys, my question for you is, what are some of your favorite movies to watch strictly due to the cinematography?" I'll let you think about that for a second. Yeah. A couple come to mind for me. One is House of Flying Daggers.
Mm, that's a good one.
Hero with Jet Li.
Oh, man.
That movie, I think, from a pure cinematography, and cinematography isn't just getting great shots of mountains and everything like that. When you look at the use of color in Hero, the Jet Li film, every frame of that freaking movie is a work of art. Like, every frame. It is one of the most breathtakingly beautiful films you can ever just sit down and watch with the sound off if you wanted to. Like, seriously, it's fantastic. Now, going back to just sweeping landscapes, another one, Lord of the Rings films, the original Lord of the Rings films for me, the way that Peter Jackson used that New Zealand countryside was just beautiful and made you feel the scope of the story. But House of Flying Daggers, the Lord of the Rings trilogy, but my number one for me, if you just want to work a pure masterclass in cinematography, watch Hero. What about you?
Well, I mean, all the movies that I'm going to pick are actually movies that it's not just for cinematography, because, but they're, it's one of the main elements. And it's a recent movie. The first two are recent movies. That's Sicario. The way Deakin shoots that movie, it's one of those movies I remember watching, being so into the story, but then really noticing how beautifully it was shot.
Yeah.
Another one is Revenant. Is another movie.
Oh, that was gorgeous.
You just feel like you are there. You feel cold when you're on. You could use
all natural light for that.
Yeah, man. Yeah. It was, and one of my favorite movies of all time, that the cinematography is as much of a character as anything else, is Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. Mm. There are so many different shots in the way that Michel Gondry this just kind of sets up it's that one shot that I think of is when he goes back into his childhood memory and he's underneath the chair, the way, and watching the behind the scenes on how they did that. It's amazing. She's like full scale, except, and it's not CGI, and he's looking like a little kid, but it's the way they shot it, and it's amazing. I there's everything I love about that movie: the music, the acting, and the cinematography.
All right, this next question comes to us from Ike Moore, who writes, "What do you think makes a great sequel?" Well, off the top of my head, the first thing that comes to my mind is just a good movie. The same things that go into make a great movie are the things that make a great sequel. Yeah. When you look at the failures of things like, you know, great original movies like Analyze This, and then you go into Analyze That. You get The Hangover, then you get The Hangover 2, or whatever the case may be. It's because just the second movie on its own was not a good, solid movie. There's no magic trick to this. You just have to make a great movie. And that's what makes a great sequel. I don't know. Can you go any more deeper than that?
Yeah, because especially for what you just brought up, the two examples that you gave are comedies. And you can pretty much count the good comedy sequels maybe on two hands if you're lucky, but probably five or six good comedy sequels. And the reason I think that this is the case is because when it comes to comedy sequels, a lot of times it's just about you're trying to not do the same jokes, but they fall into doing a lot of the same jokes because it's not original.
Hangover
not
was the worst for that.
And it's not doing anything because it's just about the jokes, as where other movies that have sequels to them, whether it's an Empire Strikes Back or Return to the or Two Towers, whatever it might be, it's furthering the story.
Yeah.
And a good sequel furthers the story to either conclude the story or get you to the third or fourth one to want to see more of them. Comedies, that's not the goal. The goal is not to try to further the story or enrich the story of it. You want to be involved in the story, obviously, but it's to make you laugh as much as you did in the first one.
Yeah.
That's hard to do two times in a row. That's why it's very rare. So I think that that really has a lot to do with it. It's a matter of what makes a good comedy sequel in the case of just non-comedies. Further the story, give, you know, and enrich the characters, take the character somewhere new and I always go to Star Wars, but when I met Luke the first time, he's significantly different and his mission was a lot different than Empire Strikes Back. That should be the case with anything, whether it's a Star Wars or a brand new franchise, whatever it might be. That's what has to happen.
When you're thinking of comedies that got as good or better in their second films, what are some? I mean, the first one that comes to mind because it was recent was like 22 Jump Street. Was definitely one of them. To me, Rush Hour 2 was a big improvement over the first one.
I throw in there too, and that had a little bit of a benefit too because it was an action comedy. I think action comedy can rely on. I think that some people will see the third one, but I like the second Austin Powers. I thought the second Austin Powers was pretty good. And again, Neighbors 2 was fine. It wasn't as funny. It was fine. But it wasn't horrible. And that's a good thing for a second. Because a lot of times, it's like you said, Hangover 2, Hangover 3, it was just putting another nail in the coffin.
All right, next question comes from Connor McKenna, who writes, do you think an actor or actress in a sci-fi movie or genre film will ever be nominated for an Oscar?
What happened?
There's this little guy, you might have heard of him, called Heath Ledger, who won the Academy Award for playing the Joker.
Oh, Amy Adams didn't get nominated, did she? She did this year.
I do not believe she did.
Oh, right. Okay.
No,
I thought she did, but I mean the movie did. So
yeah, the movie got nominated, but actors and actresses role. No, it's happened before. It will happen. It'll continue to happen when the right roles come out. I'm going to tell you right now, there is a legit possibility. I'm using the word possibility, but it is a legitimate possibility that you're going to see. I think Patrick Stewart could be up for a Best Supporting Actor nomination at the end of the year. And Hugh Jackman, with all the buzz that's going to surround and all the success, and everybody's going to be talking about this, there is a legit possibility that Hugh Jackman could be around come Oscar time next year. But there's a lot of films to come up between now and then.
The problem is that it came out so early already in the year. It's March, the beginning of March, and then, I don't know. And even the critics themselves saw it in like February. But to answer the question, we're going to see now whether or not a comic book movie gets nominated. Yes, it has happened before with Heath Ledger, obviously. But
Alien Covenant's coming. It's got a lot of powerhouse actors in there.
It's possible, but I think that you're going to probably see something like along the lines of whether it's like an Inception or Arrival, things of that nature, to where it's not the traditional big blockbuster. I think it's going to be harder for the blockbuster thing. Certainly can happen, but I think it's harder.
All right, guys, that'll do it for this installment of Mailbag. Thank you so much for joining us. Don't forget, guys, email us in your questions anytime to collidervideo@gmail.com. I want to thank my co-host today, Mr. Christian Harloff. Christian, where can people find you online?
Twitter and Instagram every Tuesday and Friday here, the Movie Trivia Schmodown, and Collider Jedi Council on Thursdays.
And you guys can follow me simply on Facebook and on Twitter, just @JohnCampion. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. Keep up to date on everything going on here at Collider Video. And until next time, bye-bye.